By the end of the 1860s, the Western world had entered the railway age. Tracks stretched across much of North America, Britain, and continental Europe. They tied together major cities, and they opened up new regions. Soon, people began to talk about a Newfoundland railway. One of its earliest proponents was a Canadian engineer named Sandford Fleming. He was working on a railway through the Maritimes when he became interested in extending the route across Newfoundland. Fleming's idea was to create a transportation network between Europe and North America. Passengers could travel from Ireland to Newfoundland by steamship, cross the island by rail, and then take a ferry to Nova Scotia and the Intercolonial Railway. Fleming predicted that a Newfoundland railway would shave 4 whole days off the trip between London and New York. The Newfoundland government was interested. It asked Fleming to head up a survey of the island in 1874. When the report came back 1 year later, it recommended that the government build a 360-mile track from St. John's in the east to St. George's in the west. The estimated cost was $8.5 million. It wasn't quite what the government had hoped for. First, the price tag was too high, and second, having a terminus at St. George's posed significant problems. The community lay on the French treaty shore. Building a railway there would stir up international political problems. The government decided to shelve the railway for the moment, but interest continued to grow. Supporters argued that a trans-island railway would help to build Newfoundland into a prosperous and modern nation. They pointed to recent geological surveys of the island, which suggested that its interior held rich mineral and timber resources that awaited development. A railway would grant access to these lucrative lands and help diversify the colony's economy into areas other than the cod fisheries. One of the most vocal advocates of the railway was Moses Harvey. He was a well-known naturalist, essayist, and minister. On February 11, 1878, Harvey delivered a public lecture in St. John's that called for the building of a trans-island railway.
It means the opening up of this great island, the union of its eastern and western shores, the working of its lands, forests, and minerals, its connection with the neighboring continent. It means the increase of population, the conversion of the country into a hive of industry, the commencement of a material and social advance to which, at present, no limits can be set. Once it is built, all things are possible.
The railway received widespread public approval later that year when William Whiteway became the colony's new prime minister. His Conservative Party had won the November general election on a platform that promised action on the railway. In 1880, the government decided to build a 340-mile railway from St. John's to Halls Bay with a branch to Harbor Grace. The new route avoided the problem of the French shore by ending at Halls Bay instead of St. George's, and the branch line between St. John's and Harbor Grace made sound economic sense because it would service the most populous part of the island. The government decided to lay down a narrow gauge rail instead of the more expensive standard gauge. The move saved money in the short term, but it would create significant problems in the long run by limiting the amount of freight that could be moved over the line. But for the moment, the government believed that its cost-cutting plan was the best choice. It came with an estimated price tag of only $4 million, far below the $8.5 million needed to build the longer standard gauge line to St. George's. But as surveyors investigated the new route, heated debate sprang up around the railway. Those in favor predicted that it would create jobs and diversify the economy into new areas. Others questioned those claims. They argued that the tremendous costs of building and maintaining a railway would plunge the colony into debilitating and long-term debt. Some feared that the financial burden might even lead to confederation with Canada. Among the opponents was Stephen Rendell, a politician and manager of the Water Street firm of Job Brothers. He outlined his fears to the Legislative Council on April 22, 1881.
Those visionary pictures of unbounded prosperity and cessation of pauperism described by railway enthusiasts amongst us as the inevitable consequence of the work, and the statements that those holding adverse views are only standing in the way of the people obtaining food, is all claptrap and nonsense, calculated to lead the country astray, make them discontented with their present lot, unsettle their minds, and make them worse off than they were before.
Some families were also worried that the government would take away their lands for railway construction. This was especially troublesome in rural areas where there was often no formal title to land. Tensions boiled over in Foxtrap. Many families there kept large farmlands which they had spent years and in some cases generations tending. If the government claimed this property for the railway, then it would threaten their livelihoods. 500 townsfolk blocked the survey team from entering their community on July 22, 1880. The standoff lasted for 5 days before police arrived from St. John's to disperse the crowd. Despite these protests, construction proceeded. In 1881, the government awarded a contract to Albert Blackman to build the railway. He was a New York lawyer who headed a syndicate of investors. Construction began on August 9th. By the end of the year, 10 miles of track had been laid in St. John's, and the first locomotive had arrived from Prince Edward Island. 400 workers were employed on the project, and more jobs were opening rapidly. The next summer, passenger trains began to move between St. John's and Topsail. The Sunday afternoon excursion trains were a popular service, but they also drew the ire of local church officials. In 1883, the Sabbath School Convention publicly condemned them.
Resolved that the Sabbath School Convention of Newfoundland, in its own name, and in the name of 10,000 Sunday school scholars and workers whom they represent, and in the name of the great Lord of the Sabbath, desire to protest in the strongest way against the desecration of the Lord's Day by the Newfoundland Railway Company in running Sunday excursion trains.
Despite these protests, the Sunday excursions continued, and so did railway construction. But not without significant problems. In 1882, Blackman and his syndicate began to run out of money. By the spring of 1884, they were bankrupt. The Newfoundland Railway Company was placed in receivership under Sir Francis Evans. Fortunately for the government, Evans decided to finish the Harbour Grace branch. It opened about 6 months later. 84 miles of railroad now snaked through the most populous parts of the island. The volume of traffic was good, and the branch generated a modest profit. By then, Sir Robert Thorburn was Newfoundland's new Prime Minister. He didn't support a trans-island railroad as much as Whiteway did, but he did want to create jobs, and the railway seemed like a good way to do that. Encouraged by the success of the Harbour Grace branch, Thorburn decided to build a second branch on the Avalon Peninsula. The result was the Placentia branch. It opened on October 2, 1888. It ran 26 miles from Harbour Grace Junction to Placentia. 1 year later, Whiteway was re-elected to office with a strong mandate to resume construction of the Trans-Island Railway to Halls Bay. His first order of business was to find a contractor, and the man he chose was a Scottish engineer named Robert Reed. The Reed family would go on to manage the Newfoundland Railway for the next 3 decades.